the universe, a vast and seemingly infinite void of matter and energy, dispersed throughout the fabric of space-time. As it currently stands, our universe, by the notion of the Big Bang, is roughly 13.8 billion years old, with a universal temperature of 2.7 Kelvin. This is our current universe. Previously on this channel, we've explored our universe's theorized past. If you haven't seen the first video in this series yet, I highly recommend you check that one out first. The link to that video will be in the description. Now back to where we left off. Today, in a world full of curious celestial objects, we know that all the matter that is visible to us makes up only 4.7% of the universe. We call this baryonic matter, which simply means any object that is composed of protons and neutrons. Within this grouping, 4% is considered to be free-floating hydrogen and helium, dispersed throughout the emptiness of outer space. 0.5% of the matter in this grouping are stars, one of the most populous objects we can spot while looking up at the night sky. Finally, the remainder of the 4.7% that is yet to be accounted for are all the heavy elements we see on the periodic table beyond hydrogen and helium. As we've explored previously, the process in which all these heavy elements form is through nucleosynthesis, which is the formation of atomic nuclei from protons and neutrons. In this process, however, although a handful of heavier elements form through a star's fuel-burning process of nuclear fusion, the grand majority of heavy elements form at the end of a star's life. Whether it be a planetary nebula or a supernova, which depends on the mass of a star, new elements form, such as gold and uranium, which cannot be naturally obtained in any other way. Yes, the silver or gold jewelry many of you may be wearing while watching this video was created in the heart of a dying star. But what about the remaining 95.3% of matter that has yet to be explained? As abundant as it may be, much is not yet known about this remaining composition that makes up a grand majority of our universe. 0.3% of the cosmos is composed of neutrinos, which are considered to be non-baryonic matter, since a neutrino is its own subatomic particle that is neither a proton nor a neutron. Being extremely small and extremely weak interacting particles, they are typically described as ghost-like. To put in perspective just how many neutrinos there are in the cosmos, about 100 trillion of them pass through your body every second. We will go more in depth on this subatomic particle, along with many others in a future video, where we'll explore more about the standard model of elementary particles. Next, responsible for a much larger percent of the cosmos is dark matter, composed of a whopping 27% of our universe. But even that is nothing in comparison to an unrelated term coined as dark energy, which is thought to make up 68% of our universe. Although both of these vitally important topics to cosmology will be covered in the next video on this channel, essentially, dark matter is an additional invisible mass that is believed to have a gravitational hold on baryonic matter, responsible for why massive objects such as galaxies are able to be held together. Dark energy, on the other hand, is thought to be associated with the accelerating expansion of our universe, acting as a repulsive force to increase the size of the cosmos. Although it may be easy to attribute these two phenomena with each other, dark matter and dark energy are not thought to be related whatsoever. Instead, the reasoning behind why both of their names are described as dark has to do with the fact they are not thought to interact much with ordinary matter, as well as being highly elusive to the conventional methods astronomers use to detect things. Given this peculiar composition of the cosmos, let's circle back to the 4.7% of the universe that we are familiar with. Besides the immeasurable stretches of empty space, dark matter, and dark energy within our universe, the cosmos also has plenty of hydrogen and helium gas, the first two elements on the periodic table. When clumped together via gravity in massive quantities, nebulae are formed. Eventually, these nebulae become massive enough to form stars, which have many variations. Whether they be blue, white, yellow, orange, or red, each star is unique in its own sense of mass, luminosity, temperature, and more. Such stars can be grouped together into different star categories, for which they may be main sequence stars, giants, supergiants, white dwarfs, and boundless more. There are so many different types of stars out there that it becomes complicated to group all of them into straightforward categories. Even beyond the lifespan of stars, the death of certain stars is even more fascinating. Such objects formed after the subsequent death of stars include, but are not limited to, neutron stars, pulsars, magnetars, and black holes. Despite all these different variations of stars, there is still more, as when anywhere from hundreds of millions to even trillions of stars become clumped together in a confined section of space, we call this a galaxy, such as our Milky Way galaxy, which contains anywhere from 100 to 400 billion stars. That's not all, though, as when a collection of galaxies become gravitationally bound to one another, we call this a galactic cluster. The galactic cluster that our Milky Way galaxy lies within is called the Local Group, containing 36 galaxies. You may think this is the end of how big things get, but we're not done yet. As when many galaxies and galactic clusters become grouped together, we call this a supercluster. And the supercluster that we reside in is called Laniakea, to which it is estimated that there are roughly 10 million superclusters in the universe. At this point, we've gone as far out as we possibly can in terms of the cosmos. However, some dare to take it one step further and say that our universe is just one bubble of many, many others, in an ocean full of other universes. This concept is coined to be the multiverse, but we'll save that for another video. One final point to note about galaxies before we move on to colder regions of the cosmos is the various shapes and sizes that galaxies may be found in. The galactic shape we are most familiar with are spiral galaxies, in which galaxies just like our Milky Way galaxy are shaped like disks with arms, spiraling from a bulge at the center, which commonly contains a supermassive black hole. The spiral shape has been found to be the most common shape of galaxies discovered thus far, having everything within these galaxies rotate in the same direction around a galaxy's center, like a rapidly spinning pinwheel. Next is the lenticular shape, which is similar to spiral galaxies in having a central bulge, but lacks arms, meaning these lens-shaped galaxies don't rotate fast enough to create said arms. There are also elliptical galaxies, which actually look a little like footballs with the notion that they are oval-shaped. Containing trillions of stars, the largest galaxies in the universe happen to be elliptical, having stars and matter within rotate around the galaxy's center in multiple directions. The last galactic shape is called irregular, and is considered to be the miscellaneous group of galaxies. Holding shapes that are hard to define, it is suspected that these galaxies are being forced into irregular shapes, such as needle-like, rings, and cloud-shaped, due to the gravity of other nearby galaxies tugging on them. As we've made our way throughout our universe, we've only discussed the hot stuff that resides within galaxies, galactic clusters, and superclusters. But, as we all know, there is much more to the cosmos than what burns brightly in outer space. Besides the fact that space itself resides on the cusp of the coldest temperature physically possible of absolute zero, there are worlds like ours, not as cold as our space, nor as hot as stars can get. Planets like ours, that reside within the circumstellar habitable zone, which is anywhere around a star, in which temperatures allow liquid water to exist. There are also bits of frozen rock, ice, and dust scattered aimlessly throughout the cosmos, capable of forming objects such as comets, asteroids, moons, dwarf planets, and more. At this point, we've explored a grand majority of the curious objects we observe throughout our current universe, giving us a better understanding of just what is out there in our never-ending cosmos. A lot of content in this video was only covered at a surface level for the sake of clarity on the main focal point of this video, but all those topics will get their own respective videos in the future, where we'll learn even more together. I hope you've enjoyed watching this series as much as I've enjoyed creating it, and I hope you'll join me for the last video in this series, where we'll explore our universe's future ahead. Thank you all for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider liking and hitting that subscribe button with the notification bell on. To learn more about our current universe, see the links to the research I used for this video in the description. I highly recommend checking out the first video in this series. For that video, see the link in the description. If there are other ideas you'd like to see covered in a future video, please leave it in the comments below. Have a great day, everyone, and remember to stay curious.